Hi guys, and welcome to this video. Today I'm going to be talking about my favorite song from each of the Beach Boys studio albums between 1962 and 2012. I have my beloved Help Me Rhonda shirt on that was given to me by a friend, so it looks like I'm ready to go. I also have my my pick-me-up to get me through this. I mean, should I just put it there? Does anybody really want to see me? Should I just leave it like that for the whole video? And just talk like this? I don't know, I feel like that's pretty weird. Nah. If you'd like to leave a comment, your opinions are always welcome. Just, you know, remember to be respectful. I will definitely try to get back to you. So without any further ado, we're gonna travel back to the very start, 1962, with Surfing Safari. My favorite from Surfing Safari is probably Surfing Safari. Okay, moving on. 1963, I believe, Surfing USA. I'm gonna have to go for Surfing USA. So far I'm just working eponymously, it would seem. Moving on, also 1963, Surfer Girl. Eponymous thrice in a row. No, this one's more difficult. We also have There's Surfer Girl, Hawaii, and In My Room up for contention. As far as I'm concerned, I'd say it's probably between Surfer Girl and In My Room. It's got to be between those two. However, Surfer Girl, it's just timeless. It is absolutely timeless. So I'm going to go for Surfer Girl. So thrice in a row, I've gone eponymous. Okay, moving on. Little Deuce Coupe. Again, 1963. This guy, Brian Wilson, was already on fire by this point. And for me, this one is between Spirit of America and Be True to Your School. Spirit of America, Brian's trademark falsetto. I think I say that objectively it is the better song. However, Be True to Your School, it's just one of those early Beach Boys songs that's just so cheesy. Singing it unironically, and it kind of is sweet. It makes it endearing. I really love Be True to Your School. Okay, so moving on. Okay, so this should be Shutdown Volume 2, 1964. Obviously, Don't Worry Baby. It's classic. And I think this overshadows everything else on the album, which is why I feel the warmth of the sun is overlooked. Now, I know that Mike Love wrote the lyrics, but again, it's Brian. Thematically, it's Brian. Credit where credit is due, Mike Love did a fantastic job with The Warmth of the Sun. Interestingly enough, was written as a tribute to John F. Kennedy on the day that he was assassinated. And Brian Wilson is quoted as saying that the mood just kind of took over one of his most spiritual songs, and both he and Mike Love were just completely blown out by it. Okay, so moving along, also 1964, we have Awesome Along. Of course, I Get Around. Everybody knows this. It was the first Beach Boys song I ever heard before I knew who the Beach Boys were. I love it. I love I Get Around, but for me on this album, I think a lot of people don't know about this song. We'll Run Away is fantastic. Brian's falsetto, the structure of the song, the progression, the melody, I think is wonderful. I think the harmonies when they come in. Wow, it's a great piece of music. It is a great Beach Boys record. Moving on, I'm actually going to take this opportunity to mention the four by the Beach Boys EP. I guess this is cheating, but it means that I can single out Wendy, which is on Awesome Along, but I wouldn't have chosen it as my favorite. But I'm going to use this opportunity to say Wendy is a great song. I love the harmonies. So yeah, Wendy. Also, I'm going to start doing this. See? Presenting it to you like that from now on. Okay, so moving along, also 1964, the Beach Boys Christmas album. There it is. Hopefully this works. Little Saint Nick, all day, every day. Especially, is it the single mix that has the sleigh bells prominently in the mix? Little Saint Nick is a great song that I will listen to all year round because I just love it. Yeah. Okay, moving on, 1965, the Beach Boys Today. And this is where I'm really gonna struggle. This is where it starts getting very, very difficult to break things down and single anything out in particular. This is pretty much the moment when Brian really, really became Brian Wilson. The term genius is used as kind of a throwaway superlative these days. If anybody likes a musician, they'll just say genius. And I really don't like it because I think in this case, Brian Wilson is a bona fide genius. Between 1965 and 1967, this man was functioning at a level rarely seen outside of an academic capacity. He's the first auteur in the music industry. He has complete control over everything. He's producing the Beach Boys records, but also Capitol Records want him to produce for other people. He's writing the songs, composing, arranging. He's the Beach Boys go away on tour, they come back, and he teaches them all their parts. He does everything for everybody. From the bass line all the way to whatever is stacked at the top, he's writing every part for every musician in the ensemble. He started using the Wrecking Crew predominantly around this time. And then how nice for the Beach Boys to come back from tour and they have this genius waiting for them at home. He's written all of these songs. You don't have to write anything yourself. He's already arranged harmony stacks, all your vocal parts, and he just throws them out like that, teaches them to all of you. In terms of today, I just have to say that I wish Guess I'm Dumb, which is a song that Brian wrote for Glen Campbell. I wish the Beach Boys had done their own version and that it was on this album. Also, All Dressed Up for School. I absolutely love that song, and I also feel it should have been on this album. Somewhere on the first side, probably next to Dance, Dance, Dance. But anyway, it's still, even without those, this is still just the perfect record. You know, a lot gets made of the Beach Boys and the Beatles' rivalry and how these two bands, essentially, along with Bob Dylan, but these two bands in particular, they basically push pop music further in a 3-year span than it probably ever has done since, because of their rivalry and competitive spirit. See, it starts with Rubber Soul, the first true concept album, then that inspired Pet Sounds, Pet Sounds inspired Sgt. Pepper. But to me, it seems that Brian Wilson was always just ahead of the trend, because I see Today, which was released before Rubber Soul, as being a concept album. They talk about it like it's half an album, because the first half is still rudimentary stuff, whereas side two is, everybody always singles out side two of this record, but I just see it as, usually with a band, you'll have one record, and the next record sounds completely different. You have no idea what happened in between. With Today, you're seeing that, the segue in between. Side one of the record is the previous Beach Boys in spirit, and the second side, Cher side, moving forwards. And I love that juxtaposition. Now, to me, this is purposeful, but Brian Wilson being Brian, he's so incredibly humble. He just lets the Beatles take the credit for Rubber Soul, because he loves Rubber Soul so much. Of course, Rubber Soul definitely did inspire Pet Sounds to be a thematic whole. But then people say Pet Sounds inspired Sgt. Pepper, but they seem to forget Brian Wilson also beat the Beatles, Sgt. Pepper, with Smile. Unfortunately, Smile wasn't released, but this was in the making before Sgt. Pepper. Paul McCartney was even in attendance at some of the Smile recording sessions. And this isn't me trying to rewrite the narrative with my own agenda. I love the Beatles also, but I just think objectively, everything that I can see, Brian Wilson, and I keep saying Brian Wilson, not the Beach Boys, because let's face it, the Beatles are a better band than the Beach Boys, but Brian Wilson is better than the Beatles as a collective whole. You know, they needed George Martin. They all needed each other. Brian Wilson was Brian Wilson solely on his own, doing everything. But anyway, even though I have my Help Me Ronda on, it's definitely not my favorite from the album. I think most people would say Please Let Me Wonder. It's really difficult. It changes all the time. Please Let Me Wonder, In the Back of My Mind.
I know it's so hard to find girl who really understands your mind. What would I do if I lose her? It'll always be in the back of my
Kiss Me Baby. I also really like When I Grow Up to Be a Man. The harmony stack at the start of that song, off the top of my head, I cannot think of the chord right now, but that is like a 6 stack. It's incredible. The arrangement, I think because of the stylization, true compositional innovations on that album by Brian Wilson. Please Let Me Wonder. So moving on, 1965, Summer Days and Summer Nights. This is kind of a bit of a regression. Capital, after the release of Today, they wanted Brian to go back and write in, you know, in a stylistic way similar to the earlier hits. So, and it actually works very, very well. Some of these songs on this record are amazing. California Girls, Little Girl I Once Knew, You're So Good to Me. California Girls is one of the greatest Beach Boys songs of all time. But for me, the most overlooked Beach Boys song of all time, it is on this album, and it is called Let Him Run Wild. By all accounts, Bruce Johnston, other members of the Beach Boys, they recognize this kid, Brian Wilson, has something. This guy is extraordinarily gifted. Let Him Run Wild is staggering. It is staggering. And it's one of my all-time favorite Beach Boys songs. So, Let Him Run Wild. Okay, next, 1966 and Pet Sounds. I mean, I don't even need to do that. I got it down here. I have a shitload of books about Pet Sounds. The Beach Boys' Pet Sounds, the greatest album of the 20th century by Kingsley Abbott. What else can you say? That's all that needs to be said. For the record, I have to say mono. Pet Sounds has to be listened to in mono. See, you have to remember that the Beach Boys' Pet Sounds, as most people know it, did not even exist until 1997 with the release of Pet Sounds Sessions, which I have somewhere. I don't know where I put it, so I'm just going to show you like this. That's the first time Pet Sounds was released in true stereo. I have to say, while I appreciate it, it's more viable for a modern audience. I do love aspects of it. For me, it's just a completely different experience. For example, just listen to Pet Sounds, the song Pet Sounds. Yeah, I know exactly who is responsible for that. It was Kingsley fucking Albert, and it was really nice about him as well. Keeps doing it. Can't trust him. But anyway, yes, just listen to the eponymously titled song Pet Sounds from Pet Sounds in mono versus stereo, and you'll see exactly what I mean. What I will say is that the stereo, some of the instrumental tracks, particularly Don't Talk, Put Your Head on My Shoulder, the sonic width on the stereo version is like a film score. It's so cinematic, especially when the timpanis come in after the middle eight section. It's so cinematic. Incredible. But anyway, Pet Sounds, for me, it's between three songs. They're probably not the standout songs from the album, but Caroline, No, I Just Wasn't Made for These Times, and Don't Talk, Put Your Head on My Shoulder. I think I'm going to have to go with Don't Talk, Put Your Head on My Shoulder. It's my most listened to track on Last.fm. I just think it's one of the best pieces of music that I have ever heard. As much as I love I Just Wasn't Made for These Times, the tempo blocks, the wall of sound during the chorus, and it's a very, very strange song. There's a vibe on that record. I cannot put my finger on it. It's amazing, but I'm still going to have to choose Don't Talk, Put Your Head on My Shoulder. That's my favorite song from Pet Sounds. Okay, so moving on, 1967 and Smile. So this is an alternative reality where Smile was actually released. It would not have had the cultural impact Sgt. Pepper ultimately had in terms of innovation, compositional exploration, studio exploration, innovation, approach to song form and structure, all the strides that Brian Wilson was making with Smile. It's better than Sgt. Pepper, which I don't even consider the greatest Beatles album. So, I mean, the material on it is just staggering. Cabin Essence, wonderful. Heroes and Villains, Good Vibrations. I mean, Good Vibrations, holy fuck, what a song. To play the various different studios like that for the ambient noise of the studios, this guy was just on another level. This is why I just have so much admiration for Brian Wilson above anybody else in the music industry, even to this day. He is completely unsurpassed. For me, it's got to be the song Surf's Up. It's got to be Surf's Up. I genuinely see Surf's Up as being the apex of Brian's creative genius and an apex in pop music in general. Bohemian Rhapsody, that's an apex in popular music. Surf's Up is an apex in popular music. At the point where one can almost transcend, God is tangible. And then the curve starts to arc back down and ends up with Brian in bed masturbating to Hey Little Tomboy. It captured something on tape that most recordings, especially digital recordings, simply cannot capture. It's really ominous as well. It's the way that the piano chords during the second movement are so sparse. Meanwhile, the deep Moog bass just kind of rumbles and tears through the record, and it makes me feel kind of seasick and like the entire structure is just hanging in suspension. For me, at least, time feels warped on this record. It creates the illusion of how powerful this piece of music is. It's one of the most ethereal things I've ever heard. And I know that a lot of people who are aware of Surf's Up feel exactly the same. They know what I'm talking about. They know what I'm talking about right now. I heard the word, wonderful thing, a children's song. That is just an enlightening moment.
I heard the word, wonderful thing, a children's song.
That is a symphony to God. Okay, so moving on. Brian Wilson had a mental breakdown. Smile was not released. Instead, we got Smiley Smile, 1967. Oh, by the way, I just realized I have this here the whole time. I was supposed to show it when I was talking about Pet Sounds. Oh, well. But anyway, so from Smiley Smile, I'm going to have to choose one of the songs that is not basically upcycled, downcycled, deconstructed from Smile. So I'm going to choose Little Pad. It's my favorite song from Smiley Smile. Okay, so also 1967, Wild Honey. This is a cool album. This is a really underappreciated album by the Beach Boys. I love the sound. I love the production. Everybody Knows Darling. It's the standout track on the album. It is by far the best track on the album, but it is not my favorite. I love Aren't You Glad. I think Aren't You Glad is one of Mike Love's best vocal performances. I think it's a great song. Here Comes the Night. It's such an interesting song. How the chorus loses its tonal center. In fact, every song on the album is great, apart from the final two. Mama Says, I don't like it. It's a rehash. It's apart from Vegetables from Smile, and also How She Boogalooed It. It's not Brian. The album is almost completely Brian, except that you just have Boogaloo stuck on at the end, and it's like, why? You could have placed Can't Wait Too Long on there, and also the Beach Boys cover of The Letter. And for me, even though it's a cover, with the addition of Can't Wait Too Long and The Letter, remove Mama Says and How She Boogalooed It, that is one of the best Brian Wilson records we would ever have had. But it's still a great record, and my favourite is Aren't You Glad? Okay, so moving on, 1968 and Friends, probably the least known Beach Boys album from this era, but it is one of the best. It was absolutely fantastic. It did not sell at all, but the whole vibe is just so tranquil, it's so peaceful and so relaxing. I even like Transcendental Meditation. People don't like how it's a complete shifting tone and vibe at the end of the record, but I love it. I Went to Sleep, which would later appear on 2020, should definitely have been on this album. So if you can take that from 2020, put it onto Friends, perfect. It would be 10 out of 10 for me. Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant album. But my favorite song from Friends has to be Here in the Morning. But I would also like to add that Little Bird is the objectively a standout song from this album. Compositionally, I never really believed that it was written solely by Dennis, because it just had so many Brian Wilson tropes. And I've subsequently now realized that it was Brian Wilson who was responsible for the song structure and form. They actually use an excerpt from Child is the Father of Man from Smile, part of the Life Suite, the Surf's Up Suite. They actually use it buried within the mix in Little Bird, and I don't know how it took me as long as it did to realize this. And I just think that's so interesting. So moving on, and we have 2020. This one is easy for me, Time to Get Alone. It's a waltz. I love waltzes. I love Brian's waltz. It's beautiful. I have to say I prefer Brian's vocal on Time to Get Alone over Carl. Just does nothing for me. I love Carl. I love Carl's voice, but on some records it just doesn't do anything for me because it just feels contrived. It's Brian Wilson, you know, he's singing from somewhere deep within, and his voice just hits me in a way that Carl, he just doesn't on this record. So Time to Get Alone, but I'm gonna go for the Brian Wilson vocal take.
Touch of your cheeks when they're rosy and cold feels so cozy to hold you, to take you close and keep you warm. The stars in the heavens get to twinkle and bright, and we'll see tonight and tomorrow we'll be glad we came. It's time to get along.
Interestingly, it was not even written for the Beach Boys. It was written for the band Redwood, who would become Three Dog Night. Brian wanted to start moving away from the Beach Boys, working with other people. Basically, Mike Love got wind of this. He came down to the studio, caught Brian Wilson with Redwood, with Danny Hutton, and they took Brian out of the studio, took him to one side, and they basically, as they always did, bullied him. Brian Wilson came out of the studio with tears in his eyes and turned to Redwood and said, "Sorry, I can't work with you. I've got to work with the Beach Boys." Just awful. Everything this man did for the Beach Boys, and it's shocking. It's shocking how he's subjugated like that. Ultimately, this led to him being in the position, vulnerable position later in life, where he could be exploited by a fucking maniac like Dr. Eugene Landy.
Financial advantage of you.
Financial advantage on the medicine that keeps me in an even place so I don't go.
Everybody's to blame in this, including Brian, but he was not treated well. Brian Wilson has never been treated well in his life. And then lastly, to round off the 1960s, before we move into the second part of this video, the 1970s, I want to give an honorable mention to the non-album single Breakaway. Great, great song. The harmonies on this song are, I think people overlook this, but there's some really, really cool things going on. The vocals are just, they're amazing. This was one in particular that Brian was really obsessed with. He loved it to the point where, like Heroes and Villains, he kept going back, changing the mix. There's so many mixes of this song. Brian was obsessed with this song in the same way that he was obsessed with Heroes and Villains. Thankfully, this one did not break him. Written with his father Murray, one of those moments where they actually came together and produced something amazing. They had a very difficult relationship, but I think it's obvious that Brian Wilson deeply, deeply respected his father. I've read about his management of the Sunrays, and they were also fond of him. I think he was just a very, very confused, jaded person who was jealous of Brian, and it's no excuse. It is no excuse, but I think he loved Brian. I know that Brian loved his father. When his father passed away, it killed Brian. And you know, he just stayed in bed for 2, 3 years, however long it was. There's so many apocryphal tales about his bedroom years, but yeah, he fell into a huge pit of depression. Anyway, I was going to go on to say how Brian has always required a paternal figure or anchor in his life. However, this video has already far exceeded the intended duration. I didn't intend to include so many anecdotes and analysis. But hey, I mostly post these videos just for me. But if you did enjoy it, remember to like, which I'm going to flip this video so it will be there. Remember to click like and also subscribe because there will be more. Why will there be more? Well, hey, I said that I was going to do every album from 1962 all the way to 2012. I've only done the 60s so far. The video became so long, I've decided to split it up into sections. So yeah, next we'll be covering the 1970s, which is interesting to say the least. There's going to be more Landy stories, which is why I just kind of alluded to it just before we broke off here. And then after that, we'll be covering the 80s, which... That's a real minefield, that's all I'm gonna say. So yeah, I hope to see you again soon, and if you enjoyed the video, then that is cool, like I say. Just for me, but if you enjoyed it, that's cool. So until next time, love and mercy, good vibrations, and I am gonna break away, so